Mr. Monaghan, I am so excited to have this opportunity to interview you. Thank you so much for doing this.
Well, thanks for having me.
Well, those of us in the foster care community have been inspired by you for many years. So I would love for you to just kind of talk to us about your experience in foster care, and starting with maybe how old were you when you first entered the orphanage?
Well, I was four when my dad died, and I spent a couple of years with in a foster home with a couple, and then I went to the orphanage for 6 years from the age 6 to 12. And then I got out of the orphanage. I was in foster homes most of the time until my senior in high school, and I lived with an aunt.
Mm. Well, so I've heard you talk about working on a farm.
Yes.
Was that with a foster family?
Yes, these are foster farms, I call them. Yeah. And I did chores, and I enjoyed farm work very much. And I worked so hard that they would usually give me an allowance, like $2 a week, which is a lot of money in the early 50s.
Right. And so what would you say that you learned from foster care or the time in the orphanage? Is there something that stands out in your
mind? Well, the thing in the orphanage, I had all Polish sisters from the old country, and they were very holy, and we had school right at the orphanage in the early grades, and that's where I got my faith. We had mass every day. We had the benediction every day. We had long morning prayers, long evening prayers, and of course, there were statues and pictures in every room of saints and Sacred Heart and Our Lady. We were completely enveloped in Catholicism, and I was very fortunate.
Wow. So what got you through those childhood years after losing your father?
Well, I was a daydreamer. And I used to think a lot about what I was going to do when I could control my life and get on my own. So I did a lot of fantasizing.
And that
was an escape, too.
Okay. So did some of those fantasies come true?
I'd say most of them have.
Oh, my goodness. That's wonderful. So did you dream about being a business owner?
I dreamed about, yes, I was naturally entrepreneurial, I think. And I always wanted to have a nice home, and I loved cars and boats and airplanes, and so I ended up having all those things.
Oh my goodness. So now when you left foster care, what'd you do?
Well, one of the problems of being on a foster farm is I couldn't play basketball. I loved basketball. So I came back to live with my mother, who was, she had emotional problems. Mm-hmm. And so I played basketball, but she put me in a detention home. And so the coach worked something out so I could get out for practice and the games. And then my aunt found out about this, and she got custody of me from the judge and brought me to back to Ann Arbor where I was born, and I lived my last year with my aunt, and that was like a dream come true.
And that was that allowed you to play basketball?
Yes, I did play basketball my senior year.
Wow, so were you in public high school last year?
No, it was a Catholic school.
That was still Catholic school? Yeah. All right. So then when you graduated from high school, mm-hmm. What did you do?
I was on my own the day I graduated. That was the understanding. I had to rent a room and get a job. And then I saved money to go to a small college. I wanted to be an architect. And then I got good marks, and then I transferred to the University of Michigan, but I didn't have money to go there. So I ended up joining the Marine Corps. Because the recruiter told me I joined for 3 years, I'd get 2 years of college all paid for. And that was all recruiting talk, because I ended up in the infantry.
Oh, my goodness.
But it was the best thing that ever happened to me. That was a best education I could have had was 3 years in the Marine Corps.
Really? Mm-hmm. So would you recommend the military for foster kids exiting the system now?
I would recommend the Marine Corps, for sure.
Really?
Yeah. I've often said that I wouldn't give any of my sons a dime until they spent at least 2 years in the Marine Corps.
Really?
But I had four girls, so I couldn't, I wasn't tested on them.
Oh my goodness. So then, 3 years in the Marines, mm-hmm. and what'd you do when you got out of the Marines?
Well, I saved most of my money I made in the Marine Corps, and I lost it all just before I got out to a con artist that I met hitchhiking back to the base, right here in Pendleton.
Oh no.
And, so I got out of the Marine Corps broke. I went to Michigan, but I had no money. I went to school for 3 weeks and didn't have textbooks. I scraped up just enough for tuition. So I dropped out. I figured I'd get some money together. I worked two or three jobs. And the next semester I went back, and after working so many hours, I just said, well, I better drop out for another year. And that's when I was approached about a pizza place nearby that it's a hole in the wall that was closed up. And it was $500 down, and borrowed money from credit union to make the down payment, and I thought I'd pay my way through college, and I was losing my shirt, and working 100 hours a week, so I'm still a freshman. After all, I was stuck there for 38 years.
Wow, what a place to be stuck. So you dropped out, and you bought that pizza place for the purpose of raising money to go back to school.
Yes.
Well, so somewhere along the line, you decided to build a school.
Yes.
Tell us about that.
Well, I was on the board of six different Catholic institutions of higher learning, including a seminary. And I saw how some of them were very good in their Catholic identity, and some were very bad, mm-hmm. unbelievably bad. Mm-hmm. And I didn't see a school out there that was strong academically and faithful to the teaching of the Catholic Church. I thought there was a need for a school like that, a beacon for other schools, because a lot of schools are trying to come back to their roots, but I think they need somebody to show them how to do it. And so we started the first new Catholic university in the country in 39 years, Bobby Graham. And they say they were the most watched Catholic school in the country by other Catholic schools. And First Things magazine just named us the most Catholic of all the Catholic schools in the country.
Wow, the most Catholic of all the Catholic schools in the country.
Yeah, and we're blatantly Catholic.
You must be so proud of that.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Wow. So now, why should a foster kid leaving the system and looking for an education go to Ave Maria University?
Well, it's the best combinations of strong, rigorous studies in the liberal arts with a strong spiritual component, and it's small. And everybody knows each other. Everybody lives on campus. We have outstanding faculty. They're all PhDs, and so from the finest schools: Harvard, Princeton, Yale, Oxford. University of Michigan. So it's in a town all designed to be supportive of a Catholic university. We have three masses every day, a confession every day, a lot of clubs. The biggest club is the pro-life club. Second largest club, which is started by students, is the Chastity Club. And it's the best place to meet a spouse for life. We get a lot of engagements and marriages.
Oh, my goodness. I love it. So they can get their degree and their MR and their MRS as well.
That's right.
Yeah.
That's right.
Oh, my goodness. Well, now, what advice would you give to a kid leaving the foster care system with no family, no support, no resources? You've been there. What would be your best advice?
Well, do what I did. I got a job. I lived very simply. I rented a room for $6 a week. It probably costs $25 today. I bought a used bike, and that was my transportation. And I worked long hours, got all the overtime I could. Every payday, I'd I went down to the bank and deposited everything I, except what I needed for food and rent that week, and, mm-hmm. And a little spending money. And so I couldn't get my hands on it. I built up enough money to go to the college. And that was, and I think my training in the orphanage net enabled me to have that kind of discipline to do that. I didn't go out and buy a car and rent a nice apartment or anything. There's an old saying that there's three S's for a man's life. The first is survival.
Okay.
The second is save, and the third is serve.
Survival, save, and serve.
And one way of saving, as I did, is just build a business and plow everything back into it and grow it. That's a form of money in the bank, but I built up equity. It's a form of saving.
So when you started that company, you borrowed the down payment.
Yes.
And then worked 100 hours a week.
That's right. And for one point, for a while, I even slept on the pizza table.
Wow.
Couldn't afford the room rent.
So rather than room rent and or a nice apartment or buying a car or whatever else, you put all your money into that business and built that business.
And I ate a lot of day-old food in the bakery, and I had a lot of burnt pizzas and bad orders.
Oh, my goodness. Wow. So at the time that you sold your company, how many stores did you have?
I had 6,250 stores in 65 countries.
6,250 stores in 65 countries.
Yes.
From that one little pizza place.
One little hole in the wall.
Wow. Mr. Monaghan, are there any last tidbits of advice or words that you'd like to share with foster kids who are listening?
Well, I think the most important thing one can do for business and for life is to practice your faith and have a close relationship with God and His mother.
Very good. Well, thank you so much. This is means the world to me, and I know that all of us in the foster care system and advocates across the country will just be so inspired by this. So thank you again.